Open your Bibles with me to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. A little bit of, I don't know what it is, in the mic. Isaiah chapter 61. I'm just going to share a couple of verses as a preface to our Independence Day message. This verse, Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 1, is a verse that Jesus quoted concerning himself as he began his earthly ministry. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath set me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. Again, Jesus quoted that and applying that passage to himself. Jeremiah chapter 34 and verse 8, we find a similar passage. This is the word that came unto Jeremiah from the Lord. After that, the king Zedekiah had made a covenant with all the people which were at Jerusalem to proclaim liberty unto them. And if you've ever seen the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia, you have seen the inscription that is engraved in that Liberty Bell from Leviticus chapter 25 and verse 10. Proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. Proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. This Old Testament verse refers to the Jubilee, or the instructions to the Israelites to return property and free slaves every 50 years. The Speaker of the Pennsylvania Assembly, Isaac Morris, chose this inscription for the State House bell in 1751 to commemorate the 50th anniversary of William Penn's 1701 Charter of Privileges, which granted religious liberties and political self-government to the people of Pennsylvania. The State House bell, now known as the Liberty Bell, rang in the tower of the Pennsylvania State House. Today we call that building Independence Hall. I'm going to give more detailed events relative to our Declaration of Independence today than I have in the past. And I'm going to throw in some appropriate historical data to help us get a better understanding for what it is that we are celebrating here on Wednesday, July 4th. Sadly, to many Americans, July 4th is simply a day off work, a day to barbecue on the grill, a day to go to the beach or go to the mountains, a day to party, a day to go to fireworks, or other such activities. Very few Americans seem to really understand what Independence Day is and what it represents. I want to try to do my best today to give you some of the information that we need to truly celebrate the Declaration of Independence. I want to begin by sharing a letter that Abigail wrote to her husband John Adams. This letter and several others are in our freedom documents. This is the last week, by the way, for those of you online, that we are making the freedom documents available. So if you don't have a copy yet, then you need to order this week. Here is the letter that's written on June 18, 1775, right after the Battle of Bunker Hill. She talks about Bunker Hill, she talks about the destruction of Charlestown, and she talks about the death of Dr. Joseph Warren, one of the leading patriots in the independence movement, a medical doctor who his hands were all over the independence movement leading up to the events of 1776. He was a leader in the committees of correspondence, very integral part in the network of men and women who kept the Liberty message alive, the Sons of Liberty, and all of that. He was the one who dispatched Paul Revere and Mr. Dawes to warn the people at Lexington in Concord about the British that were marching to arrest Sam Adams and John Hancock, and to seize the cache of weapons at Concord. That was Dr. Warren. You don't hear his name as much as you should. Dr. Warren was a great, great, great patriot. He died on the battle at Bunker Hill. Abigail addresses this in her letter. The letters between John and Abigail are themselves a great history lesson as to our country's formation. Tremendous information contained in the letters between John Adams and his wife Abigail. This is Abigail writing to John. The day, perhaps the decisive day, is come on which the fate of America depends. My bursting heart must find vent at my pen. I have just heard that our dear friend Dr. Warren is no more, but fell gloriously fighting for his country, saying, better to die honorably in the field than ignominiously hang upon the gallows. Great is our loss. He has distinguished himself in every engagement by his courage and fortitude, by animating the soldiers and leading them by his own example. A particular account of these dreadful, but I hope glorious days will be transmitted to you, no doubt, in the exactest manner. The race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but the God of Israel is he that giveth strength and power to his people. Quoting the Old Testament. Trust in him at all times, ye people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is a refuge for us. Charlestown is laid in ashes. The battle began upon our entrenchments upon Bunker Hill a Saturday morning about 3 o'clock and has not ceased, and it is now 3 o'clock Sabbath afternoon, meaning Sunday. 'Tis expected they will come out over the neck tonight, and a dreadful battle must ensue. Almighty God, cover the heads of our countrymen and be a shield to our dear friends. How many have fallen, we know not. The constant roar of the cannon is so distressing that we cannot eat, drink, or sleep. May we be supported and sustained in this dreadful conflict. I shall tarry here till 'tis thought unsafe by my friends, and then I have secured myself a retreat at your brother's, who has kindly offered me part of his house. I cannot compose myself to write any further at present. I will add more as I hear further. and she always signed her letters Portia. Here's the story of the Declaration. While political maneuvering was setting the stage for an official Declaration of Independence, a document explaining the decision was being written. On June 11, 1776, Congress appointed a committee of five, consisting of John Adams of Massachusetts, Benjamin Franklin of Pennsylvania, Thomas Jefferson of Virginia, Robert Livingston of New York, and Roger Sherman of Connecticut to draft a declaration. Because the committee left no minutes, there is some uncertainty about how the drafting process proceeded. What is certain is that the committee, after discussing the general outline that the document should follow, decided that Jefferson would write the first draft. The committee in general, and Jefferson in particular, thought that Adams should write the document, but Adams persuaded the committee to choose Jefferson and promised to consult with Jefferson personally. Considering Congress's busy schedule, Jefferson probably had limited time for writing over the next 17 days and likely wrote the draft quickly. He then consulted the others, made some changes, and then produced another copy incorporating the alterations. The committee presented this copy to the Congress on June 28, 1776. The title of the document was A Declaration by the Representatives of the United States of America in General Congress Assembled. Congress ordered the draft lie on the table for 2 days. Congress methodically edited Jefferson's primary document, having reduced the writing by one-fourth. Congress removed Jefferson's assertion that Britain had forced slavery on the colonies, which it had. In order to moderate the document and appease people in Britain who supported our revolution. Although Jefferson wrote that Congress had mangled, his word, his draft version, the declaration that was finally produced, according to his biographer, John Furling, was the majestic document that inspired both contemporaries and his posterity. I'm going to take you through the events now leading up to July 4th. If you will listen carefully, whenever we show the video that we're going to show you at the end of my remarks, you are going to see these things reenacted on film, and you'll be able to recognize the history of this, and I think it'll make more sense to you, and if you listen carefully to this chronology of events. On Monday, July 1st, having tabled the draft of the Declaration, Congress resolved itself into a committee of the whole, with Benjamin Harrison of Virginia presiding, and resumed debate on Lee's, that would be Richard Henry Lee's, Resolution of Independence. John Dickinson, who you're going to see in the film, made one last effort to delay the decision, arguing that Congress should not declare independence without first securing a foreign alliance. John Adams gave a speech in reply to Dickinson, restating the case for an immediate declaration. You're going to see that in the film as well. By the way, here is Richard Henry Lee's Resolution for Independence, the one that was voted on and the one that passed. Resolved. You'll see this in the film, not all of it, but some of it. Resolved that these United Colonies are, and of right, ought to be, free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is, and ought to be, totally dissolved, that it is expedient forthwith to take the most effectual measures for forming foreign alliances, that a plan of confederation be prepared and transmitted to the respective colonies for their consideration and approbation. That was the actual resolution. After a long day of speeches, a vote was taken. Again, this is on July 1st. As always, each colony cast a single vote. The delegation for each colony, numbering anywhere from 2 to 7 members, voted among themselves to determine the colony's vote. Pennsylvania and South Carolina voted against declaring independence. The New York delegation, lacking permission to vote for independence, abstained. Delaware cast no vote because the delegation was split between Thomas McKean, who voted yes, and George Reed, who voted no. The remaining 9 delegations voted in favor of independence, which meant that the resolution had been approved by the Committee of the Whole. The next step was for the resolution to be voted upon by the Congress itself. Edward Rutledge of South Carolina, who was opposed to Lee's resolution but desirous of unanimity, moved that the vote be postponed until the following day. On July 2nd, South Carolina reversed its position and voted for independence. In the Pennsylvania delegation, Dickinson and Robert Morris abstained, allowing the delegation to vote 3-2 in favor of independence. The tie in the Delaware delegation was broken by the timely arrival of Caesar Rodney, who voted for independence, and you will see that depicted in the film. The New York delegation abstained once again, since they were not authorized to vote for independence, although they would be allowed to do so by the New York Provincial Congress a week later. The resolution of independence had been adopted with 12 affirmative votes and 1 abstention. You will see that in the film. With this, the colonies had officially severed political ties with Great Britain. And every man who signed his name to that document at that moment became a traitor in the eyes of the British Crown, and under the sentence of death by hanging, according to a dictation given by King George. And you will see that in the film. After voting in favor of the resolution of independence, Congress turned its attention to the committee's draft of the Declaration. Congress made a few changes in wording. On July 4, 1776, the wording of the Declaration of Independence was approved and sent to the printer for publication. Let me share with you a sample of some of the comments that were made by some of the Founding Fathers after the Declaration had been signed. John Hancock, who is the one you see when you look at the copy of the Declaration with the big signature, bigger than anybody else's. As soon as he had written his signature in that fashion, he said this: "There, His Majesty can now read my name without glasses, and he can double the reward on my head." George Washington said, "The preservation of the sacred fire of liberty." I love that phrase, the sacred fire of liberty. The fire of liberty goes out, and then liberty itself is extinguished. Without the fire of liberty, liberty will not exist. the preservation of the sacred fire of liberty, and the destiny of the republican model of government are justly considered as deeply, perhaps as finally staked on the experiment entrusted to the hands of the American people. Thomas Paine. Those who expect to reap the blessings of freedom must, like men, undergo the fatigue of supporting it. Stephen Hopkins, one of the signers of the Declaration, said, "My hand trembles, but my heart does not." This is what John Adams wrote to Abigail after the Declaration had been signed. This was written on July 3rd, the day after the vote was taken on July 2nd, that you're going to see enacted in the film. Had a Declaration of Independence been made, by the way, some of this letter is also seen in the film. Had a Declaration of Independence been made 7 months ago, it would have been attended with my great and glorious effects. We might, before this hour, have formed alliances with four foreign states. We should have mastered Quebec and been in possession of Canada. You will perhaps wonder how such a declaration would have influenced our affairs in Canada, but if I could write with freedom, I could easily convince you that it would, and explain to you the manner how. Many gentlemen in high stations and of great influence have been duped by the ministerial bubble of commissioners to treat, and in real, sincere expectation of this event, what they so fondly wished, they have been slow and languid in promoting measures to the reduction of that province. Others there are in colonies who really wish that our enterprise in Canada would have been defeated, that the colonies might be brought into danger and distress between two fires and be thus induced to submit. Others really wish to defeat the expedition to Canada, lest the conquest of it should elevate the minds of the people too much to hearken to those terms of reconciliation which they believe will be offered us. These jarring views, wishes, and designs occasioned an opposition to many salutary measures which were proposed for the support of that expedition and caused obstructions and embarrassments and steady delays which have finally lost us in the province. All these causes, however, in conjunction, would not have disappointed us if it had been not for a misfortune which could not be foreseen and perhaps could not have been prevented. I mean, the prevalence of the smallpox among our troops. This fatal pestilence, complete with our destruction, is a frown of providence upon us, which we ought to lay to heart. But on the other hand, the delay of this declaration to this time has many great advantages attending it. The hopes of reconciliation, which were fondly entertained by multitudes of honest and well-meaning, though weak and mistaken people, have been gradually and at last totally extinguished. Time has been given for the whole people maturely to consider the great question of independence and to ripen their judgment, dissipate their fears, and allure their hopes by discussing it in newspapers and pamphlets, by debating it in assemblies, conventions, committees of safety and inspection, in town and county meetings, as well as in private conversations, so that the whole people and every colony of the 13 have now adopted it as their own act. This will cement the Union and avoid those heats and perhaps convulsions which might have been occasioned by such a declaration 6 months ago. But the day is past. The day, the second day of July, 1776, will be the most memorable epic in the history of America. I am apt to believe that it will be celebrated by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival. We celebrated on July 4th, not July 2nd. Adams missed that. It ought to be commemorated as the day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty. It ought to be solemnized with pomp and parade, with shows, games, sports, guns, Bonfires, bells, illuminations from one end of this continent to the other, and from this time forward forevermore. You will think me transported with enthusiasm, but I am not. I am well aware of the toil and blood and treasure that it will cost us to maintain this declaration and support and defend these states. Yet through all the gloom, I can see the rays of ravishing light and glory. I can see that the end is more than worth all the means, and that posterity will triumph in that day's transaction, even although we should rue it, which I trust in God, we shall not. So wrote John to Abigail on July 3rd. Our declaration begins with these words. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. Four times in the opening remarks of the Declaration, Thomas Jefferson makes reference to Almighty God. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government, becomes destructive to these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, invents a design to reduce them under absolute despotism. A synonym for design is conspiracy. It is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having the direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. And the bulk of the Declaration is a pronouncement of those causes. Then the Declaration ends. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connections between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states, they shall have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Indeed, the signers of America's Declaration of Independence endured the sacrifice of toil and blood. Of those 56 men who signed the Declaration of Independence, 9 died of wounds or hardships during the war, 5 were captured and imprisoned, and in each case, tortured. Several lost their wives, their children, or their entire families. One signer lost all of his 13 children. 2 wives were captured, brutalized, and tortured. All were at one time or another the victims of manhunts and driven from their homes. 12 signers had their homes completely burned. 17 of the signers lost everything they owned. To me, one of the most amazing acts of providence associated with our story of Declaration and Independence is what happened to John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. During the months and years leading up to the Declaration, Jefferson and Adams were close friends. The Declaration of Independence would not have happened, it is safe to say, without both Thomas Jefferson and John Adams. It would not have happened. After America won its independence, George Washington, of course, became our first president, which you will see his swearing in on the film in a moment, which according to all the history that I have read about that ceremony, the way it's depicted in the film is exactly the way it happened. Most of the words associated with the acts of Congress that you're going to see in the film are historically accurate, not ad-libbed. After we won our independence, George Washington became our first president. He chose John Adams as his vice president. Actually, back in those days, the delegates chose. After George Washington served his 2 terms in office, by the way, George Washington was so admired, revered, and adored by the American people. Whenever he was first elected president, many of the American colonies wanted him to be America's king. as the King George was in Great Britain. Had not George Washington possessed the tremendous humility and constitutional acumen that he had, he would have probably submitted, as most would do, especially these days, to such a demand, and America would have had a monarchy. After having fought a monarchy to win independence, it was very possible that a monarchy would have been recreated right here in the United States. George Washington firmly rebuffed such a request, insisted that we have a constitutional republic complete with a presidency, not a monarchy. And after two terms, they wanted him to continue to serve. There were no laws in those days against a president serving more than two terms. But he said that two terms was more than sufficient for any president to serve. And he voluntarily stepped down. There are many tragedies of the modern American politically correct environment that has enveloped our land, that has enveloped both the Republican and Democrat parties, that has enveloped both the Democrats, Republicans, conservatives, and liberals. It's a tragedy. Our minds and what we revere in our minds and what we detest in our minds is the strongest indication of who and what we are as a national people. For 150 years or so, George Washington was considered the greatest American to ever live. He was considered and is called the father of his country. First in war, first in peace, first in the hearts of his countrymen. George Washington was considered across the board as the greatest president America has ever had. Over the last few decades, the opinion of the consensus of the American people relative to George Washington has completely been perverted to the point that now we have a sizable number of the American population, including college professors, high school teachers, including politicians, including ministers of the gospel, men in the pulpit, including educated men across the country, now despise George Washington. Many people are calling for his memorials to come down, to rename the monument in Washington, D.C., to try and disparage his honor, his character, to turn him into something that should be disdained in our minds. These people, by destroying the character, the integrity, the honor, the influence, and the importance of George Washington to the American nation, are destroying America itself. I don't care what you hear in school, kids. I don't care what you hear in college. I don't care what you hear at work or wherever you have your activities. To this very day, George Washington is the greatest president America has ever had. But without Jefferson and Adams, the Declaration of Independence would have never happened. the American secession of Great Britain, from Great Britain, would never have happened. There were several other men, of course, that would also need to be put in that category, including Washington. But these two men in particular were extremely important to the Declaration itself. You're going to see John Adams in the film respond to Mr. Dickinson on the floor of the Congress in the debate of the Declaration. The words are factual. You'll get a sense of the importance Adams played in that Declaration. As Washington's vice president, it was somewhat predictable that he would have become America's second president following Washington's departure from the presidency. It was at this point that his policies differed greatly from the policies of Thomas Jefferson. Adams adopted a more centralized view of government. He actually led the early nation at that point to centralize its government in Washington, D.C. There were some things that happened during his administration that were absolutely, in my opinion, antithetical to the Declaration and injurious to the principles of liberty. At this time, Thomas Jefferson, ever the separatist, ever the individualist, ever the freedomist, departed from Adams' political philosophies. There was a great falling out between these two men. And after Adams' first administration, Thomas Jefferson ran against him for the presidency. It was a bitter campaign. These two former friends were now bitter political enemies. Adams promoting greater centralized government, Thomas Jefferson promoting state autonomy, state sovereignty, individual freedom. There has not been an American of greater conviction to the cause of state sovereignty, individual liberty, and the principles formulated in the Declaration of Independence than Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson, along with Benjamin Franklin, probably the two most intelligent men of the 100 or so men that we call the Founding Fathers. Jefferson, the quiet, unassuming, shy personality who spoke most fiercely with his pen. John Adams, the boisterous, outgoing patriot, now at loggerheads. Thomas Jefferson won that election, became our third president. John Adams was so angry that he had lost to Jefferson, that he would not attend the inaugural. And that is how they parted company after the election of Jefferson. But time went on. Years go by. And now both Thomas Jefferson and John Adams are old men. And in their waning days on this earth, they each, without anyone contacting the other or without any outward pressure on these men, innately, individually, within themselves, they buried the animosity that they had toward the other. And their heart swelled up with pride of having been the friend of the other. The flame of love and friendship was lit in their hearts for each other by God Himself, in my opinion. They could not go to the grave at aught with each other. The last words of John Adams: "Thank God, Jefferson lives." What John did not know is that both he and Thomas Jefferson died on the exact same day. And you know what that day was? July 4th, 1826. 50 years to the day of the Declaration of Independence that those two men were so much responsible for. On August 2nd of that year, Daniel Webster gave the eulogy for both men. He ended his eulogy with these words: "It, the Declaration of Independence, is my living sentiment, in blessing and by the blessing of God, it shall be my dying sentiment. Independence now, and independence forever."